It's like it's been a while.
Yeah, for some of us.
For some of us.
Let's get out there, brother, we have to be months.
Well, you know, it's heathens. So our guest, teacher this morning is Dr. Lee H. Butler Jr. Lee is the Vice President of Academic Affairs and Academic Dean, and William Tabernay Professor of the History of Religions and Africana Pastoral Theology at Phillips Theological Seminary here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Lee came to Phillips in the summer of 2020 from Chicago, where Lee was a distinguished professor of theology and psychology at the Chicago Theological Seminary for 24 years.
Wow.
Distinguished service professor. Lee, in 2006, Lee was the first African American to be promoted to the rank of full professor at CTS. Lee also founded the Center for the Study of Black Faith and Life at CTS. He is an ordained minister of the American Baptist Churches USA, a preacher, scholar, teacher of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, author, and accomplished fly fisherman. If you thought his photo in the Challengers chat was distinguished, you should have seen the dapper photo of himself that he sent me in his fishing waders, sunglasses, vest, ball cap, fly rod, holding a very nice trout from the White River below Tanicomo in Missouri. Not only was he dapper, but he was dry. Lee and his wife Mary have been married for 32 years, apparently in it for the long haul, as well as the long distance, as Mary has remained in Chicago to be with her daughter until she recently left for her senior year in college in New York. It's good to get to know Dr. Lee Butler and hear his reflections on Black faith and life. And before Lee comes up, let me offer a word of prayer. Indeed, our gracious God, we are so grateful for this most beautiful morning, for the gift of the miracle of another day of life. We are truly grateful for Dr. Butler, for Lee. We thank you for instilling in him the spirit and desire to discern and articulate and edify and share your presence and your action in our lives. We thank you for instilling in us the spirit of learning and growing and serving. And we just ask that we will hear your message and your learnings for us today, this morning, please, the rest of this day, and each and every day. Amen. Please.
Thank you for that lovely
a description of me, introduction. This is, yes, my first year in Tulsa, and this is my debut at any church in Tulsa. So, thank you very much. And I think it is very appropriate that this be the first church that I come to, given the long history relationship that this church has with Phillips Theological Seminary. My first time to this lovely building, this campus, was for the memorial service of Reverend Dr. Don Pittman. And I did have an opportunity to have dinner with Don before he made his transition from life to life. But it was so wonderful to be here and hear the stories that I never heard before. That's one of the lovely things about a memorial service. You really get the inside scoop in a way that you didn't in the short encounters. And so after the memorial, I was talking to his mother and meeting some of his sisters. And they were like, well, who are you? I said, well, I'm the new Don. Because in fact, not only was he vice president of academic affairs, academic dean, he also held the same chair that I held. So our titles are exactly the same. And I'm in a lovely tradition of Don Pittman, Nancy Kerr Pittman, and now Lee Buckley and Matt Phillips, leading the academic life. And so I'm delighted to share with you this morning from this topic, let's talk about Black faith and life. As has been pointed out, I founded a center at Chicago Theological Seminary that was named the Center for the Study of Black Faith and Life. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the kind of work I've done in the past, but also contextualize it. The kind of work that will be done, that is being done, here in Tulsa through the Phillips Theological Seminary. So the first thing I think it's most important for me to say to you, as a baseline for our discussion, is to identify the fact that African-American Christianity does not trace its existence to the Protestant Reformation. When we talk about the Christian church in America, we generally go back to the Reformation and talk about what it means to be Protestant. And so there are all these great reformers that marked the different Protestant denominations. But the African-American tradition, the African-American religious experience, did not come to the Reformation. It was affected by the Reformation, but it did not come through it as a way of saying, we are breaking away from the Catholic Church and expressing faith differently, saying that we can speak directly to God. True statement among African Americans, but it's not one that comes through the Reformation. So we have to think about African-American religious experience and the African-American church differently because it has a different origin. To the extent that the Reformation and the Enlightenment gave rise to capitalism, that is not disputed, that it was through the Reformation, through the Enlightenment, through the new definition of what it meant to be human that came through this period that also inspired folks to develop capitalism, to say that we have the capacity, the ability, we have the right to seek our own welfare, being, and good. So to the extent that the Reformation and the Enlightenment gave rise to capitalism, which also gave rise to the Atlantic trade and human suffering, also identified as the Atlantic slave trade, but I prefer to call it the Atlantic slave or trade in human suffering because The Africans who were taken from the continent, from their homes, understood themselves to be human beings, but through that process of enslavement, their humanity was denied. And so to talk about a slave trade is to deny the humanity, the dignity that Africans had when they were captured and enslaved, that their identity was not that of slave, but enslaved persons. And so to the extent that the Reformation and the Enlightenment gave rise to capitalism, which gave rise to the Atlantic trade in human suffering, which gave rise to the Atlantic world, a world that was shaped out of this mercantilism, this new way of understanding the world that became a globalization that began to really redefine all of humanity, that comes across the Atlantic, that region that was once thought to be flat, that you would fall off of it, but now it becomes known as a new world, the Atlantic world. African-American Christianity, which emerged from the invisible institution, is a unique religious phenomenon. The invisible institution was not the invisible church, but it was that gathering of those enslaved Africans in places of secret where they could really celebrate being alive. The enslavement that they experienced was life denying, it was death dealing, it was dehumanizing, but when they got together outside of the eyes of those persons who were holding them captive, they were able to express their full humanity and declare that they were loved of God in those places that are called the hush harbors or rush harbors. It was not a church, but it was something else, because it was the combination of the Christianity that they encountered and their African indigenous religions that were a part of their heartbeat and the souls of their being, and the combination of these two traditions and the experience of enslavement brought forth a new manifestation, one that was not recognized by white America. Even when they looked at it, they didn't recognize what they were seeing. They didn't interpret it correctly. So it was the invisible institution that gave rise to African American Christianity. Now, as Christians, you might say, but Christianity changes how we understand ourselves. As many as were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ, there is no longer Jew or Greek, there is no longer slave or free, there is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And we live in a society that is wrestling with lots of different oppressions. And in this text we find those oppressions having been race, class, sex, and gender, the same sorts of oppressions that we are currently wrestling with. And we want to appeal to this text to say, but see, all of those things fade away when we're baptized as Christians. And yet, we know that there is still, and it was for the Galatians, they were Jew and Greek. There was slave and free. And there's always been these kinds of negotiations and struggles between male and female, men and women, trying to understand what it means to be human in our bodies that look different. And the thing that we really have to remember as we're looking at this text, recognizing that there was a Reformation that changed our understandings of what it means to be human, this text was very much alive when those first folks who were coming across the Atlantic in the name of seeking religious freedom. This text was very much in their minds, and yet they still declare some to be human and some to not be human. Some to be free and some who would not be identified as free. Because we still know that there was a big difference, even if you were actually, there was a big difference between what it meant to be men and women in the colonies. So these oppressions were very much alive. And it was through the redefining of humanity that the founders declared this new nation based upon life, liberty, and property. Yes, we said life, liberty, pursuit, happiness, but the philosophy that was informing that idea and ideology was life, liberty, and property. But when they began to negotiate that and place it into the Declaration, property became pursuit of happiness. But property never went away as a primary concern of those colonials, as a primary concern of what it meant to be American. The American dream is all about gaining your piece of the pie, establishing that house with the white picket fence. It was all about property. And in this picture, you see George Washington, one of the primary founders, the first president, the hero of the Revolution, who is standing on his plantation with Africans that he has enslaved. Folks that he has said, you don't deserve citizenship, you don't deserve freedom. Even though I fought for freedom in establishing this nation. So only those defined as human beings were identified as citizens of this nation and free. That they went on to justify themselves, because they did believe in the Bible, but they went on to justify themselves and their actions and attitudes by saying that Africans were actually cursed. See, it's in the book. It was the curse of Ham, where Noah cursed Cain, the son of Ham, and said that those descendants of Ham would be servants, slaves of their brothers forever. And so America, in its development of enslavement and slave system, which, by the way, the slave system is not one thing. Were you aware that indentured servitude was a form of slavery? And so there were lots of folks who came to America who were enslaved. But there was only one group of folks that, through this theological interpretation, was identified as being slaves for life. Born into slavery and would die in slavery. So, taking these basic understandings, then go about recognizing and interpreting African American Christianity, the religion of Black people and their lives? Well, to make this transition, I turn to one of my mentors, Dr. Charles Houston Long, the late Dr. Charles Houston Long. He was the preeminent scholar of the history of religions, and it is my connection to him that allowed me to receive a chair at Phillips Seminary of the William Taberley Professor of the History of Religions, because my scholarly formation is in pastoral care and counseling, but I began to change my scholarly approach by working with Dr. Long and being mentored by him. So I turned to him, and a quote from an article that he wrote that was titled Passage in Prayer, where he says, "The religious community is brought to being through prayer, and prayer then forms the context of its continued existence. One might say that prayer is the essence of religion, at the very heart of religious experience. For the Africans in the bowels of the slave ships, the Atlantic represented a cataclysm." So think about that for a moment. You have a group of persons who are identifying themselves as Christians, who have captured, who have kidnapped, who have raided, and who are now transporting these souls across the Atlantic. They are folks who are above deck with another set of people below deck in the bowels of these ships. Two different peoples taking the same journey. One living in the sunshine, experiencing the fresh air of the sea, and the other living in the stench of those holds. So to whom does one pray from the bowels of those slave ships? You're being tortured, mutilated, raped in the bowels of the slave ship by one who is above deck declaring that they are following the cross of Christ. So to whom does one pray in the bowels of those slave ships? To the gods of Africa? To the gods of the masters of the slave vessel? To the gods of an unknown and foreign land of enslavement? To whom does one pray? From the perspective of religious experience, this was the beginning of African American religion and culture. This was the beginning of trying to really negotiate what it means to be human and define meaning as you're going through hell. And so there really was no way of submitting to the belief system of the one who was above death, because it wasn't working in the bowels of those ships. So what were some of the beliefs that they were bringing to the new world as they were negotiating this renewal passage experience? Well, there's often interpretations that talk about superstitions and animisms and a whole range of beliefs that are regularly degrading of African religiosity, of African indigenous experiences. But we have to understand that there was a range of faith traditions, of religious understandings of theology across the continent of Africa, even as we had this kind of range across Europe. Europeans didn't always believe in one omnipotent, omniscient God. You need only look at the kinds of spiritualities that we like to identify in the European religious traditions. But one of the understated facts about those Africans who came across the Atlantic is that many of them did believe in one God. They were monotheistic. That in the history of Egypt, and we turn to Egypt because it is one of those places where there is documentation that we can appreciate as a literary understanding of how we understand and interpret life. There was a pharaoh by the name of Akhenaten. Akhenaten is the first monotheist in recorded history. Not necessarily the first monotheist, but in terms of a documentation of one belief, Akhenaten was an African pharaoh who conformed Egypt to the belief in one God. And so if you have this African pharaoh in antiquity who is a monotheist, it stands to reason that there were other Africans who were also monotheists, because Egypt is in fact a part of the African continent. And there are theories about migration that the spread of culture and community came out of Egypt across the continent. Well, that's one way of seeing it, because another says that Egypt didn't develop from the Mediterranean inland, it actually developed from inland to the coast. Why not? Which way does the Nile flow? It flows inland to the coast. And so as the river flows, so does information flow. This is a representation of Akhenaten's family. He was a family man. Family was vitally important to all communities across Africa. His God, his one God, was the sun, Atan. And if you can see this more clearly, there are other representations that I sort of like this one. If you can see this more clearly, the rays of the sun are actually handing down the key of life. And so behind him is his wife and children. Family is important. So imagine when Africans are brought to this land and their families are being broken up, being denied. The right of family. I mean, what do we even say today is one of the markers of what makes us human? Marriage, followed by family. Which is why we engage in these various debates about who can be married to whom. Because it says something about stability of culture and community, but more importantly, is making a statement about what it means to be human. And so, we have these Africans who are being denied humanity, human dignity, human relationship, human touch. Not that they're not being touched, I'm talking about human touch, compassionate touch, tender touch. struggling with, how do we maintain our sense of being created in the image and likeness of God in this kind of environment, in this kind of situation? And we hear this wrestling when we listen to the spirituals. You see, the spirituals are theological statements being made by these Africans who are enslaved in America. Something like, Mary, don't you weep, don't you know? Didn't Pharaoh's army get drowned in the Red Sea? Oh, Mary, don't you weep. Now, you look at this and you say, well, how can they come up with this kind of song that is combining at least two different stories? Well, let's go back first. That story is very important. We're talking about people that really does engage in narrative as an oral tradition. Telling the stories is telling the history of who we are and what we believe. So these spirituals are grabbing important parts of the culture, storytelling. It's taking some of the messages that they're hearing from the Christians that they're in relationship with, the Christianity that's surrounding them, the sermons that they're hearing, and they're hearing these two stories. And Mary, who is weeping because her brother Lazarus has died. And how do you live when the one you love has been taken away? So this is a deep sorrow, a lament that is being declared by the people. The ones we love are being taken away. Death is surrounding us. And yet, also recognize that Pharaoh's army was drowned in the Red Sea. So even though death is surrounding us, there is victory for us on the other side. That there is a God who cares about us, because those folks who were enslaved in Egypt were delivered out of the house of bondage by a God who loved them and cared for them. And not only delivered them out of the house of bondage, but took care of the enemy. Pharaoh's army, who tried to come back and get it, drowned in the Red Sea. And so this spiritual, not unlike some of the Psalms, is recognizing that while we may be suffering now, we're going to be delivered by the God that cares for us. And so through this constant and continuous belief that they were human beings loved by a God who created them in God's own image and likeness, they endured until freedom came by way of emancipation. I want you to take a careful look at these pictures, these images. What was supposed to have happened didn't actually happen as represented in these pictures. The statue is one that is located in a park in Washington, D.C., named Emancipation. Remember what we said earlier about human dignity, being human, and being human meant citizen and being able to stand free. In both of these images, we see that even though it's being described as emancipation, the African is still supposed to be in a lower position. And so while we're celebrating this kind of newfound freedom, in the mind of America, there was still a level of unfreedom. Still a station that you are below and you're only blessed because I bless you. But Africans still sought to be free. We sought to be recognized as American. And so after the Civil War, you had great migration. Which included coming to Oklahoma and establishing lots of independent black towns. And also, although the Greenwood District was not an independent black town, to the extent that it was still part of the city also, it was a separate community established within the guidelines of the law. For Plessy versus Ferguson, with that landmark case that said there is separate but equal in America. And so you had a community that was so successful, so prosperous, it was identified as Black Wall Street, that you had a people that was living separate and equal. A shining example of what self-determination could do. Separate but equal. There was something in the American spirit that could not allow Africans to be equal. And so the Greenwood District had to be raised, brought down. And I selected these two images because of the ideas that are being presented in the images. Running folks out of town so that they could create an all-white town. Little Africa, so that idea of Africa was still imprinted, that these people were not seen as Americans, but something else. And it becomes an emblem of an experience that has been an American experience for African Americans. Because what happened here in Tulsa was not unique. It was identified as the worst at that time, but it was not a unique experience. To move us in a slightly different direction, talking about these facts, I want to lift up some of what was happening around the nation and in Tulsa right before I came here. Now, one of the things I identified early in the presentation is Africans in America don't owe their denominational identifications to the Protestant Reformation, and yet when you're looking at statistics that are being interpreted, we are still lumped into that Protestant Reformational interpretation. And yet I want us to see how differently African Americans tend to see the world, tend to see America. So that the Black Protestants identified as 80% of those who were voting for now President Joe Biden versus a smaller 8%. Or the white evangelical, that was 82%. The non-evangelical, they don't break it up like that for the black folk. But to see these percentages, that if we were all Christians of the same experience and the same interpretation of life, wouldn't those numbers be closer? Would there be this kind of dividing line? There are different hopes, different visions, different experiences that our religious experiences, that our denominational histories lead us into understanding and interpreting prophets. Even if you think back to June 2020, Tulsa suddenly went into lockdown around this time because there was a great fear that with the Republican Party coming here to do a rally, that there was going to be violence that could not be contained, because at this time, America really was exploding across the nation with civil unrest and protest. One year later, we have the identification of a new national holiday that is recognizing the experiences of Africans in America as it relates to our path towards freedom. And so Juneteenth became a national holiday, and a new flag was even developed with the red, white, and blue of where that statement of freedom initiated, originated, where there is now the sunburst or starburst, this new bright hope that the curve is saying is on the horizon of a new beginning. But for as much as there is a Juneteenth flag, there still remains a traditional African-American flag that says, yes, we are American. However, our experiences of America have been painful, and the promises of America have yet to be completely actualized and fulfilled. Because of what was going on in 2020 before I came, the first thing I did upon arriving in my new role as Vice President of Academic Affairs and Academic Dean was to invite folks to go through a year of study together, where we named a theme for the year being Jesus and the Disinherited, ministry responses to violence and oppression, as we engaged the fierce urgency of now. And everyone at Phillips read the book together. Jesus and the Disinherited by Howard Thurman. Because it is vitally important that we see the sources of violence and the ongoing oppression and how to dismantle these painful experiences. I am running out of time, so I'm simply going to show you the last slide that was supposed to be my invitation for us to really talk about things. That this title and this talk is really about truth and reconciliation, truth telling. The only way we can develop new relationships is if we are able to speak truth to one another and to listen to the truth being spoken. That's what results in the reconciling of relationships. And so part of my being here is for us to begin this conversation of truth and reconciliation, to talk with one another, to say that Black, particularly as we're talking about this program that is at Phillips, this Black Church Tradition and African American Faith Life program, it's not about urban. We have a program at a seminary that is usually developed or identified as Black Church. It usually means we're talking about urban ministry. Well, Black in this case is not about urban ministry, because we have Blacks all over the nation in all kinds of communities. And so it's about seeing an African heritage and identifying that heritage as a cultural imprint that can be traced from Africa to America, to the Caribbean, to South America, to England, wherever you find African people, you find African culture. That faith, we know, is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, and that informs the religions that develop. The religions that develop are our way of interpreting life. How do we navigate, negotiate these experiences that we're having? It is informed by a spirituality that is seeking to make all things one, that we're not fractured beings, but we are whole beings in relationship with the divine spirit that enlivens us. That from this we develop theology, these understandings, these interpretations, the descriptions of what it means to be human in the presence of a God that is loving but also challenging. That life is talking about culture, and culture has many different components. And this is just a short list of what makes up culture, because religion and spirituality also are part of culture. So, with the time we have left, let's talk. Yes, ma'am.
As you were talking earlier in your presentation about the origin of African American Christianity, what about the NME? Where does that fit into that study?
They were part of the Methodist Episcopal Church, the Wesleyans, they were going out of and not being permitted to worship as an equal being, as one recognized as human, they left the Methodist Episcopal Church, but still recognizing African heritage, it becomes the African Methodist Episcopal. So it was a separation that became this clearly defining moment and a clear statement of, you don't see us as different or as the same? Okay, we are different and we're going to be different. Even as we recognize that there is something valuable about Methodism, about the Wesleyan understanding, because if we go back into the deeper history, It was the Methodist and the Baptist that were most attractive to those early Africans because of the spirit movement. Great awakening and the spirit was something that was moving in these camps. The fire that was on those, they were being filled with the spirit and dancing and shouting. And so Africa said, "That's us. We've always done that." And so they were attracted to these traditions along with the rituals that were a part of the Methodist and the Baptist, like the water rituals, which was still a part of African religions. And so they were Methodists because of what was appealing to them as Africans. They stepped out, they still maintained their Africanity by becoming African Methodists.
The role that hope played. that song about Mary, don't you weep, don't you mourn. Pharaoh was in the army drowned. And how that void, those folks, all those years, that hope, that deliverance, somehow, someway is going to come, that just struck me as so profound. The depth of their hope.
Yes. Yes. And the hope was there, but one of the things that is often misinterpreted is they see it as a passive hope. They're just going to pray and wait and wait, but there was an active existence living into that hope and working for it. And so we see it during civil rights when we have folks who are marching. That was clear evidence of what was going on. Earlier, lots of resistance, struggling to maintain the dignity and working.
The action of leaving Egypt, going into the wilderness, all those years.